William Morrow and Harper Audio present Indestructible, the Unforgettable Memoir of a Marine Hero at the Battle of Iwo Jima, by Jack H. Lucas with DK Drum, read by Lloyd James.
Foreword, written by Senator Bob Dole. It is often said that the true heroes of war are the ones who don't come back. In the terrible Battle of Iwo Jima, America lost 6,821 such heroes. But for the hand of God, Jack Lucas would have been one of them. During some of the most intense fighting on that sulfur island, on D-Day plus one, two grenades rolled into Lucas's trench. Without hesitation, the 17-year-old threw himself on one and pulled the second underneath his body, absorbing a deadly blast with his own flesh and bone. Though he saved the three Marines who were with him, he did much more than that. By that act, Jack Lucas exemplified with his own blood and grit the spirit of sacrifice that won the war in the Pacific. All Americans should know his story. Our foes should contemplate it. Jack's life was not unlike my own. We both grew up during the Depression as middle-class kids in a small town, though my experience was spent in Kansas and his in North Carolina. When the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, we both knew it was our destiny to answer our nation's call. I was a college freshman whose biggest concerns were planning the next fraternity party and finding a date for Saturday night. Jack, on the other hand, was still being told what time to go to bed, and his biggest plan was graduating eighth grade. Though I knew it was inevitable I would serve, I pondered the time of my enlistment. Jack was ready to join the Marines while the bombs were still falling on Pearl Harbor. It took him almost 9 months to wrangle his way past the bureaucracy that should have kept him home, entering service 4 months before I signed up. While I was fighting Nazis in Italy, Jack was fighting the Japanese in the Pacific. Both of us witnessed a staggering loss of young American lives. Our own lives were forever changed by grievous personal injuries suffered in combat. Jack and I know the horror of feeling life draining from our bodies as we lay on the field of battle, trapped in a dull haze and comforted only by morphine. We are given only one body, and when it is broken in service to others, we have given a most precious gift. Jack and I would learn to write left-handed. Athletics would forever be out of the question, and our internal injuries would require a lifetime of attention. We were fortunate. At least we would have a lifetime. Jack and I have looked over the edge into the darkness that is death and survived to tell of the ghastliness that is war. War is not glamorous. It is ugly business, and no one escapes its effects. It can't be explained adequately to someone who has never been there. Men are never closer than when they are under fire together. In World War II, we were all brothers on the battlefield. As survivors, we are left to remember those who paid the ultimate price. They, too, are our brothers. A relationship born in battle, baptized in blood, and immortal in spirit. We honor their memory. From all walks of life they came. From the mountains, prairies, cities, and farms, they joined to serve. Death gave no heed to the privilege of their birth. They laid down their lives for the cause of freedom and for their buddies in the foxhole with them. I have always felt that what gets people through a physical or emotional crisis is having a foundation of faith in God, believing that life matters and that there's a bigger plan in play than what we can see with our human eyes. In my own memoirs, I wrote, "We need one another to defend one another, to depend on one another." They say every soldier on the front saves every other soldier's life and has his life saved by another soldier nearby. That's the fighting man's job. Jack did his job well, and, like so many that have served their country, I am proud to call him my brother. Prologue. And when he gets to heaven, to St. Peter he will tell, "One more Marine reporting, sir. I've served my time in hell." Sergeant James A. Donahue, 1st Marine Division. Though I was just 13 when I decided to march on Japan, ride the wave of American retribution, and make the Japanese pay for the attack on Pearl Harbor, I'd already passed from boy to man. I thought I knew it all. Though I had yet to see friends evaporate before my eyes, or an enemy bleed out and die by my own hand. I had loved, and now I had hated, and I considered myself more than ready to go to war. That I would find both the need and the strength to pull a live hand grenade to my gut while a second grenade lay beneath me, ready to detonate, would have astonished me, even in my moments of greatest bravado. I went to war with vengeance in my heart. I went to war to kill. Such is the irony of fate that I will be remembered for saving the lives of three men I barely knew. My journey into manhood began one bleak October afternoon when my beloved father drew his final breath, having lost his long battle with cancer. I was 11 years old. Afterward, I pushed away any man the lovely widow, Margaret Lucas, attempted to bring into our lives. I did not need a man. I was one. I was a tough kid who loved to fight. I was rebellious by nature and had a hair-trigger temper. Troubled in general. That was the young Jack Lucas. As my inner turmoil heated up, so did world events. And with the reprehensible bombing of Pearl Harbor, we both boiled over. I lived by my wits and often made up my own rules, leaving a trail of broken jaws and busted lips as I went along. So it was not much of a stretch on my part when I found my way to join the United States Marine Corps, though I was only 14 at the time. I went AWOL to catch a train headed in the direction of the war. Then I stowed away on a ship to reach one of the Pacific's worst battlefields. I figured, if I figured anything at all, that if I was shrewd enough to impose my will on the United States Marine Corps, the Japs would give me little trouble. Having already borne the weight of my life's biggest loss, I was not afraid to face whatever awaited me on Red Beach 1, Iwo Jima. I had no way of knowing that in a matter of a few short hours, I would make the most important decision of my life, and in the lives of three members of my fire team. The choice would be mine. Either I could die alone, or all of us would die together. I was decorated with the Medal of Honor, a North Carolina farm boy, catapulted to national fame. The subsequent years were mercurial, reaching heights as high as the gallery above both houses of Congress, when President Bill Clinton introduced me to my nation, and as low as discovering a contract had been taken out of my life by someone who was supposed to love me. For decades, I fought the Japanese in my sleep, my arms thrashing about, shouting sharp yet incoherent words. I would never shake the images of mutilated young men or the faces of the dead and dying. The details always stayed fresh, and my horror at their numbers never faded. Though their faces would never go away, in time I would learn to accept them as friends to whom I had made a commitment in blood to honor. I discovered that we are all a product of our own personal histories, formed by the influences of family, who likewise were formed by theirs. From my earliest memory, my parents instilled patriotism in my character. The first time a favorite uncle placed a Marine dress cover on my head at age 8, I was instantly transformed, and I knew my place would be with the United States Marine Corps. Throughout my life, the Corps has been a beacon to guide me, and an anchor to hold me, and a place where I belonged. No matter where I have hung my hat, my heart has always been with the Corps. As long as I am able, I will find the time to talk to any Marine who approaches me, and though it is a struggle, thanks to those two grenades that once burst beneath me in the black ash, I will scratch out an autograph or two. I see a little of myself in every Marine. They are bright, strong, and eager to carry the torch passed from my generation to theirs. One fact has remained steadfast. I still fully appreciate my country and those gallant Americans who serve her. They are my heroes, one and all. I turned these thoughts over in my head earlier this year as I reached down and dug deep furrows with my fingers in Iwo Jima's warm volcanic ash. I held the black grains tightly in my palm. The substance that made up this island, 650 miles south of Japan, was composed of sulfur, rock, and ash. I had returned to this beach for the 60th anniversary of the deadliest battle in Marine Corps history. It was still an ugly little piece of real estate, seemingly worthless and reeking of sulfur. However, in 1945, this tiny pork chop-shaped island was quite valuable, not only to the Americans, but to the Japanese as well. 3 years into World War II, the United States had no long-range fighter escorts to protect their B-29 bombers en route to Japan from American-held Saipan in the Mariana Islands, 1,500 miles south of Japan. In order for the United States to provide protection for these flights, as well as a safe landing site for the bombers that fell prey to Japanese fighters, it was essential an American-held airfield be situated on Iwo Jima. When a straight line was drawn from Saipan to Japan, it crossed the volcano islands at the halfway point between the two. Resting the island away from the Japanese would not come cheaply. Before this land would become American-held, our nation would pay dearly for it in the lives of our best and brightest young men. Roughly 2 miles wide and 4 miles long, this small volcanic island, one-third the size of Manhattan, was home turf for the Japanese. In their entire history, no foreign army had ever successfully invaded Japanese territory. All that was about to change, and it would change here on this island called Iwo Jima. The Japanese dug 1,500 chambers into the island rock, each connected by 16 miles of tunnels, and built on as many as 5 different levels. The Japanese strategy was simple. Every soldier was ordered to kill 10 Americans before they were themselves killed. It was not their intention to survive. These defenders of Japanese soil were prepared for the American invasion not only physically, but also mentally. It took 40 days for the fleet of more than 500 ships carrying the 4th and 5th Marine Divisions to sail from Hawaii to Iwo Jima, with a short stopover at Saipan. The 3rd Division sailed from Guam to join them, creating an armada of 880 ships, carrying 110,000 troops into battle, more Marines than ever before. Preceding the troop invasion, Iwo Jima was ferociously pounded by the United States in the longest sustained aerial offensive and naval bombardment of the war, but it had little effect against the subterranean fortresses. Burrowed into these fortifications, lying in wait, were more than 20,000 of the Emperor's soldiers. Around 0900, the first wave of Marines stormed the beach. Unable to dig effective foxholes in the shifting grains of ash, the Americans were easy targets for the Japanese. Mortars, heavy artillery, and machine gun fire crisscrossed the beaches, raining death down on the Marines and creating mass confusion. The battle that was expected to last 3 days would wage for a grueling 36. At an elevation of 550 feet, Mount Suribachi rises high above the landing beaches. From this volcanic cone at Iwo's southern tip, Japanese gunners covered every inch of the beach. Additional fortifications flanked the landing beaches. Japanese forces were equipped with rockets and anti-tank guns all at the ready. From the moment his landing craft approached, every American was always within range of enemy guns. Dogged Marines were challenging an unseen enemy and could only meet their objective by tenacity and courage, one bloody inch at a time. Before an American flag flew atop Mount Suribachi, America's fighting men suffered more than 6,000 casualties. By the end of the battle, the death toll had reached 6,821, and there were over 19,000 wounded men. In addition, more than 20,000 Japanese defenders lost their lives. It was the beginning of the end. As a young man, I was a voluntary and very eager player in this extraordinary episode of American history. At that time, I was in top physical form and ready to fight every Japanese soldier on the island. I thought I knew everything there was to know of any importance. By the time I was carried off of Iwo Jima, I had learned much more about esprit de corps and the sacrifices men are willing to make for each other than I could ever have imagined. Now, a lifetime later, this old warhorse had returned to Iwo Jima, much older and wiser. While emotions as deep as the ocean around me came flooding back, I surveyed Iwo's landscape once again, and waves of memory washed over me. Chapter 1, December 7th, 1941. When this war is over, the Japanese language will be spoken only in hell. Admiral Bill Halsey. The first news bulletins went out over the air around 14:30 Eastern Standard Time, December 7th, 1941. The Sunday afternoon NBC broadcast of Swing and Sway with Sammy Kay was temporarily interrupted to report the shocking account of the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. The announcement flashed its way from Hawaii to every corner of the world. Stunned Americans hovered over their radios, gleaning every available scrap of information from the broadcasts. I was no exception. Most Americans had never heard of Pearl Harbor, and while they may have understood little about its military significance and location, everyone was angered by the United States having been suddenly and deliberately attacked. I was a 13-year-old cadet captain at Edwards Military Institute in the little town of Salemburg, North Carolina, during that period. Along with other cadets, I was in the dining hall when word came of the attack around the time of the evening meal. The commandant, also Gavin, entered the room and asked for everyone's attention. He made the announcement, "The Japanese have bombed Pearl Harbor, destroyed a number of our ships, and killed many of our sailors." A chill ran down my spine. Having been reared with a profound love of country, I was devastated at the thought of Americans being killed and injured by sneak attack. In an instant, my life was forever changed, and from that point on, I was obsessed with a desire to kill Japanese. I was aware of Japan's invasion of China and the atrocities that had occurred in Nanjing at its hands. I knew the Germans were sinking a lot of our transport ships carrying supplies to Great Britain, and our merchant marines were being killed, even though we were not at war. My fellow cadets and I quietly left our unfinished meals and went to the nearest radio for more information. There was a radio in the day room of the barracks, and several of us gathered around it, anxiously anticipating every new report from Pearl Harbor. The details of the attack were sketchy, but the alarmed tone of the newscaster spoke volumes. America had been dealt a devastating blow. Men had died horrible deaths, and more would follow in the aftermath of the assault. I remember fearing that there would be an invasion on American soil somewhere, though no one was talking about joining the military. Over the course of the next few days, everyone was eager for America to do something. Sunday night, just after lights out, I lay wide awake in my quarters. Tomorrow was another school day, but my mind was no longer on education. My thoughts were hopelessly locked on the attack. I made every effort to sleep, but it was of little use. Every time I closed my eyes, the images of Americans dying at Pearl Harbor flashed like a Nickelodeon in my head. Though I was only an eighth grader, I had the foresight to realize the Japanese were not planning to stop in the Pacific. Their goal was Main Street in every city and hamlet in America. Something powerful was pushing me, taking control of me. I did not know it at the time, but that something was my destiny calling. I would not settle for watching from the sidelines when the United States was in such desperate need of support from its citizens. Everyone was needed to do his part, and I could not do mine by remaining in North Carolina, while one of the most dramatic events in history played itself out, half a world away. The cadets at Edwards were our nation's future military force. We were expected to someday take our place among America's fighting men. My someday was December 7th, 1941. At Edwards, we slept on metal spring beds with larger-than-usual mattresses on top. I had it better than most. I had one roommate, Bernard. Other cadets had three. There were no closets, only a wardrobe in which to store our clothing. There had been a lot of fun times shared in that room. I loved to entertain my friends by fashioning a cape out of a bath towel and leaping from the wardrobe to the bed yelling, "Look, I'm Captain Marvel." Nothing pleased me more than to make everyone laugh. From my window, I could look beyond the parade ground to the senior barracks on the other side. Prior to Sunday's attack, those barracks had been my goal. I would do well in school, be promoted to the senior barracks, and eventually.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.